I have the great pleasure of introducing my good friend, Ophelia McLean, Director, Office of Disability and Social Intervention of the U.S. Administration on Disabilities. And I want to tell you a little bit more about Ophelia. When I first started with ACL, I was doing the MTARS, which is evaluation of the USEDs and the PNAs and also the DD councils. And I was a part of the team as a self-advocate on those teams. And Ophelia was one of our first team leaders. And it was really a great experience because she really did talking about listening to people with disabilities and including us in those very big meetings that we had and doing important work like evaluating those organizations was a time that she made sure that the self-advocates on the team were listened to, our ideas were put together and able to understand what was going on and how we were involved in the training, the team training. She gave her phone numbers and her emails and was willing to stay up with us and support us and talk to us if we had any questions or any different things that were important for us to learn about. So people at the training and all of the teams that I have ever been on with her and working with people with disabilities, she really makes a difference in making sure people with disabilities are fully included. Thank you. Now, Ophelia.
Tia, you are kind. Thank you. So good afternoon, everyone. This session is going to look a little bit different than the others for some of the same reasons that Tia just mentioned. So first, I greet you on behalf of our Deputy Assistant Secretary, Allison Barkov, at the Administration for Community Living, as well as our Commissioner, Jill Jacobs. You heard from our Deputy Commissioner this morning during breakfast, Jennifer Johnson, and your program said two people will be here. It's just me today. So you are stuck with me, but that is a good thing, okay? It's a good thing. It's okay. So the format of this afternoon is going to be a little different in that for the first 30 minutes, I'm going to speak and you are also going to see a video. The second 30 minutes, I want to open it up for discussion. I know that two people have already sent questions through the app, so I encourage you to use the app for the first 30 minutes if you have any questions. I will acknowledge you when the question, the discussion period is here. But if you could put it in, you know, I'll just process it as the video comes up. If you want to wait until during the discussion, that's fine as well. We are pretty flexible here. We are all family here, okay? Something that I wanted to note, I am from the Administration for Community Living at the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. And this month, October, is National Disability Employment Awareness Month. We say NDEAM. And we want to highlight a few things as it relates to employment of people with disabilities. And the theme for this month is actually disability, part of the equity equation. And much of what you have seen so far on the IIDL side, you will notice that we are trying to ensure that people with disabilities are part of the equation. And this is also reflected in the way that the U.S. government has ensured that people with disabilities, including youth with disabilities, have equal rights. And one milestone that we wanted to mention that is in one of your questions is the Americans with Disabilities Act. And when it was signed into law in 1990, our nation recognized the fundamental principle that people with disabilities have the right to full participation within their communities. And 9 years later, The ADA integration mandate was the basis for the Supreme Court's decision, the landmark decision of OMSED. And this related to two women who had mental illness and developmental disabilities. And on June 22, 1999, the U.S. Supreme Court held that there was unjustified segregation. So with much of what occurs within the United States, in order for people to take it seriously, we have to go through the courts. And I will speak about that a little bit later, but for right now, soon you will see a video that relates to what we call at the administration projects of national significance. And this is one of the programs that is within my office. Another part of my office is the protection and advocacy systems, which is where I know Ruby Moore is. I'm also seeing a few of our colleagues here. I see Val Bradley. I also see Mike Brigiolo. He's here, yes. Of course, we know Tia. So if I don't say you out loud, is that Chernet? Oh, hi. So if I don't speak you out loud, it's simply because I don't see you from where I am. But thank you for being here this afternoon. Within the projects of national significance, money is set aside by the Congress for the Administration for Community Living to provide funding for various nonprofit organizations, essentially. And within that, we've had longitudinal data projects. There were three of them. And one relates to residential information. It is residential. I don't know what happened. Did I touch something? Residential, there we go. Residential information systems project, that is one. This one is at the University of Minnesota, and you will see them within the video. The other is statedata.info, and that one is at University of Massachusetts. And the sweet name that I really want to mention is the Institute for Community Inclusion. That is important to us. The third one is the State of the States in Intellectual and Developmental Disability, and that one is at the University of Colorado. And so they are doing very important work. And as you all know, it doesn't matter where we are from, numbers speak. So if data, if it isn't in black and white, it pretty much doesn't really exist. So we need to know that certain things are on paper. Of course it exists, but you know what I mean. So it needs to be on paper. So these longitudinal data projects were very important to us because they told us trends. They told us what has occurred and what is likely to occur in the future as a result. We also want you to watch it. Why? Because the voices of people with disabilities are heard very clearly on here. If we do not understand the heart of and hear the voices of people with disabilities, there isn't as much as we can pull from the things that we are doing. This is why we do what we do. So if the team can start it at 2:17 for me, thank you.
Hi, I'm Sherry Larson from the University of Minnesota's Institute on Community Integration. I am the principal investigator of the Residential Information Systems Project, which is one of three longitudinal data projects of national significance funded by the Administration for Community Living. And I'm here today to talk about a new product, a new resource that summarizes the results from 30 plus years of research on community living and employment. Philosopher George Santayana once said, "Those who do not remember the past are condemned to repeat it." We want people with disabilities, families, advocates, support providers, and lawmakers to know this history so that we don't repeat our mistakes and so that laws and programs can be improved. This book describes the experiences of people with intellectual or developmental disabilities who receive paid supports. People with developmental disabilities have trouble with things like speaking, learning, caring for themselves, living independently, or managing money. Their difficulties start before age 22 and require ongoing support. Intellectual disability also begins before age 22. People with intellectual disability have difficulties with practical skills, social skills, and academic skills like reading and math. Intellectual disabilities and developmental disabilities are similar, but they're not exactly the same. For example, some people with developmental disabilities have autism or cerebral palsy, but do not have intellectual disabilities. This story is about a population of about 7.4 million people in the United States who have intellectual or developmental disabilities. That's 7 of every 100 children when you include young children with developmental delays, as well as 1 of every 100 adults. Across all age groups, state IDD agencies support fewer than 1 in 5 people with intellectual or developmental disabilities, but they serve about 2 of every 5 adults, or about 40% of adults. Of the 1.3 million people served by state IDD agencies, about 910,000, or about 62%, are people who are 22 years old or older. This story is about the then, the now, and the not yet of community living. A story from Bruce Ennis, an attorney from the New York Civil Liberties Union, that was recorded in 1973 in a President's Committee on Intellectual Disabilities report, said this: "When I first saw her, she laid nude in a small, dirty, solitary confinement cell. She wouldn't talk to anyone, wouldn't even hold out her hand. Tests could not register her IQ. We placed her in a program with 1 staff member for her, 3 shifts a day. In 4 months, I went back to visit her. She was dressing herself, feeding herself. She played a record for me and showed me the paintings she had done. She also talked to me. The difference between life in a institution and life in a setting where there's sufficient enrichment and opportunity are striking. For almost 100 years, people with intellectual or developmental disabilities had to move to institutions to get an education or training because public schools did not provide educations to people with severe disabilities. Many people entered institutions as young children and never left. By 1967, nearly 200,000 people with IDD lived in state institutions. Half of those people were children. Institutions were miserable places to live." Helen Betschold said this about her life in an institution.
"Shortly after I was born, my parents gave me up and went to a place called Grafton State School. I lived there over 30 years at Grafton. A lot of hard work, scrubbing on floors, hands and knees."
Things began to change in the 1950s and then 1960s as institutions got smaller and began to close. In the 1950s and 60s, parents and advocates demanded changes to improve the lives of people in institutions. Congress passed laws to improve institutions, to provide public education to all students, and in 1981, to fund services in home and community-based settings. By 2017, fewer than 20,000 people with intellectual or developmental disabilities remain in state IDD institutions. 30 years of community living is a product that was produced in direct consultation with a team of self-advocates who advised us on what to include, what not to include, how to say things so that they could understand it. And one of those advisors was Max Barrows. He said, "People with disabilities deserve to live in the community without being segregated. When we are included, people see what we have to offer." Communities are better when everyone is included. Being included means living, working, and spending time off with family, friends, and neighbors. For adults, community living is about choosing where and with whom we live, our friends, what we do in our free time, and how we earn and spend money. Some people want to keep institutions open or create new ones. But research tells us that people who live with a family member or in a home alone or with a few other people, have better lives and make more choices for themselves. Today, things are better than they were even 30 years ago. Today, 4 of 5 people who lived in an institution 30 years ago live in community homes. An estimated 85% of all children and adults with IDDD live with family members throughout their lives. Some of those people get paid supports, others do not. By 2017, among people getting paid supports, most lived in community homes. More than half, or 58%, lived with a family member. About 12% lived in a home of their own, alone or with a roommate. About 5% lived with a host or foster family. And only 1 in 4, or about 25%, lived in a group home or in an institution. Medicaid made a big difference. In 1967, state-funded institutions were the only option to receive supports paid for by public entities. But in 1973, based on reports of the horrible conditions in institutions, Medicaid was initiated and offered money to states to improve conditions in state IDDD institutions. By 1987, 9 out of 10 people getting Medicaid-funded supports lived in a Medicaid-funded intermediate care facility for intellectual or developmental, for people with intellectual or developmental disabilities. Things changed dramatically between 1987 and 2017. By 2017, 9 out of 10 people getting Medicaid-funded supports lived with a family member or in a home in the community. By then, there were about 860,000 people with intellectual or developmental disabilities receiving home and community-based supports, and only about 73,000 people living in an ICF-IID facility. By 2017, 17 states had closed all of their large IDD institutions. 6 states did not have any Medicaid-funded institutions for people with IDDD by 2017. But we're not done yet. There's been tremendous progress over the last 30 years in improving the lives of people who receive paid supports, but we're not done. There are still 103,000, almost 104,000 people living in nursing homes, psychiatric facilities, or group facilities shared by 7 or more people with intellectual or developmental disabilities. People living in different states have different opportunities. In some states, most people getting supports live with a family member, but in other states, most live in a group home or an institution. Some group homes are doing well, but others are doing poorly. It's not easy to get a home of our own. Not every story has a good outcome. Some people go through 3 or 4 providers before finding the right place. Here are some of the other stories that their self-advocate team shared as we were preparing this report.
My biggest community transition was I graduated from high school, and the biggest issue there was I left all of my high school friends, so I had to make friends. And depending on the person or place, they need to rebuild that friendship. So for me, I definitely had to rebuild.
Well, I've lived in the community since 1990, and I've had a home, and the community has welcomed me. I'm not saying the situation I'm in is perfect, but I like living in the community, and some of the places I visit, like I like the hardware store. I live in a suburb where it's like a city in a town, and some of the stores really value me and like me and as a customer, and I gotten to know them. They're not my friends or anything, but they are people you want to see when you need a copy for something, for like human services.
Having a robust home and community-based system and having an entitlement for home and community-based services, you know, will make our lives easier in terms of getting the support with, you know, cleaning, cooking, budgeting, you know, transit to, you know, doctor's appointments, you know, job support, job coaching.
I've been living here for like 5 years now. The neighborhood I live in is particularly safe, which I like. They know me, I know them, like within my own neighborhood. So is this like a safe place, really?
I think we need to do a better job of educating them, giving the skills that people need so they can live on their own, but also allow them to fail.
I'm getting assistance through that in getting PCA. I don't know if you're familiar with that, as a personal care assistant that comes in that helps. And that companionship as well has been particularly good. And getting me outside, really. Because now I've been fully vaccinated. I've had my second shot for the COVID, so I'm in the clear now.
We need to pass the HCBS Infrastructure Act, and we need to make H home and community-based services an entitlement.
Put your money where your mouth is. Are you going to invest or not?
Our nation's social and political intentions and priorities can be recognized by how we spend our public funds. Hello, my name is Shay Tanis, and I'm the principal investigator of the State of the States in Intellectual and Developmental Disabilities Longitudinal Data Project of National Significance, and we follow the money. Our project has captured over 40 years of longitudinal data to investigate the trends in spending by public funding streams that support people with intellectual and developmental disabilities. We also investigate how those funds are used, giving us insight into programs, services, and the impact of policies across states and the nation. We do this investigation in partnership with our professionals at the state agencies for intellectual and developmental disabilities, and we thank them for their years of collaboration that has made this project possible. In 2017, over $72 billion public dollars were spent on intellectual and developmental disability services and supports. The public investment in advancing access to opportunities for people with intellectual and developmental disabilities has shifted significantly over time. While we had seen substantial investments in institutional spending in the late 1980s, that priority shifted with the deinstitutionalization movement and the advancement of community-based integration and inclusion. On the screen now, you will see spending charts that looks at spending over time, comparing institutional settings to those in the community. In 1977, $12.3 billion were spent on institutional settings, while only $4.1 billion were spent in community living. In 1989, the community spending surpassed what was institutional spending in our states. And in 2017, $64.4 billion were spent on those in the community, as opposed to $7.2 billion in institutions. The US average for annual spending per person in 2017 in public institutions was $2,094,000. Compare that to what was $49,000 per person in the home and community. So while we have seen this shift from the community to the community, we've also seen that it is more cost efficient and effective to allow people to live in their own community environments. 90% of all spending in 2017 was dedicated to community settings. But as every state is different in their administration of programs and services, so is how they fund those services and programs. We have tracked the deinstitutionalization movement through investments in public and private institutions and in nursing homes. We have tracked the advancement in community living through expenditures for public and private residential settings. We have also tracked what is supported living, personal assistance, and family support. Through this investigation, we have found that while many people want to live with their families and remain in the family home, only 4% of the 91,000 families are supported through state agency funds. And while we identify investments, we have to find a way to allow states to be compared, to know what the national trends are. We apply a unique measure of fiscal effort to compare investments for people with intellectual and developmental disabilities across the states. Fiscal effort tells us just how much a state spends on intellectual and developmental disability services, considering their own state wealth. So how does your state fare in expenditures for people with intellectual and developmental disabilities? Take a look at our 30 years of community living publication and you will see. But community living is so much more than just where we live. It is an experience of belonging and inclusion in everyday routines in our society.
I'm lucky that I have supports and government programs that allow me, but there are, if I didn't have that opportunity, I don't think I would be in my own home and in my own apartment. But the other thing, in that general sense, those that want to get married or want to have a bigger community, how do you grow that when you don't, when money is an issue or supports and services are there to allow that to happen when money is a barrier?
Also, we need to pay direct support providers a livable wage when staff turn over a lot, especially when people have job coaches. You know, oftentimes the employer will say, sorry, you can't work today if your job coach is unable to show up. Something that I had when I lived in Vermont. You know, staff turnover is traumatizing. It raises our anxiety and stress levels. Predictability and reassurance is one thing, you know, many of us in the autism world depend on.
My top three things that I would like the government to invest more in for people with disabilities are employment opportunities, housing, and transportation.
My friends have a cell phone. Why can't I have one? Technology and the help of others can help me become more independent.
It is 45 minutes long, so what we want you to do in your own spare time is to look at the rest of this. The latter part of it speaks to the employment piece, and we really want you to saturate that as well in honor of Endeem. So the first question, and whomever send that question, you can certainly raise your hand or you can read it. If not, I will read it. Okay. All right. The first question says, what advice would you give other countries that are in the early stages of policy development compared to the ADA or lessons learned? So one of the things that maybe I want to bring to our attention is one of the things I consider to be a success. And one of them happens to be the protection and advocacy systems, which is one of the ones that we have been funding since 1975. And this is where the protections of the rights of people with disabilities is, those are allowed to be held accountable. Through the PNAs. And these are organizations that are in every state and territory, plus we have a Native American consortium that sits in New Mexico, but it services four different states. This is one of the successes in that it works hand in hand with the ADA and other pieces of legislation to protect to prevent abuse and protect the rights of people with disabilities. So that's one. Maybe a challenge, if we have to make a suggestion in terms of challenges, is different interpretations of the ADA and even the Rehab Act. Because the court system says that you have the right to receive services and supports within your community. In reality, the states have funding that can assist or not assist. So there are things like waivers, you know, different state funding. Those are the things that sometimes don't seem to line up with the court system. So they don't seem to work hand in hand. There are also different types of civil rights laws that don't necessarily work at the same time and maybe assist in that way. So it depends on where you are, maybe your community, your vicinity, certain laws apply to certain types of people or certain communities, so it doesn't always look the same. One advice, you know, and of course that ties into what Tia said when she was up here and many other people. One form of advice is that people with disabilities need to be included at the priority setting process, at the beginning of the priority setting process. Also, as policies are created, the input of people with disabilities, and not just a check mark, but rather being meaningfully engaged into the policy development process, that would be helpful as well. Based on what I said about the court versus what happens in reality, one of the things that may be helpful is that you could consider how your social services align with the rights of people with disabilities, how to intersect the two. Because if you begin at the onset thinking of both of them, where the pluses are, where the minuses are, at some point you will get to a decent middle. So those are maybe my suggestions at this point. So I don't know if anyone around the table here would like, and I don't know if we have any mics, anyone around the table here would like to make any other suggestions to anyone who, in terms of the policy making process.
I will say, think about people that have lived stories with any type of organization that you are trying to build or create, and also think about the person and what they need help to make this certain dream a possibility, or whatever activity they want this to go to, and also think about who you want it to touch. Where do you want this to go, and how long do you want it to be around? And if you want it to be around, what is the implications that we need to continue to do to keep it in the loop so no one forgets where it came from and how it came about? So, yeah.
Good point, good point. Try to figure out how best to impact. Yes, yes, absolutely.
Also, when you look at the American with Disabilities Act and when it was passed in 1990, the courts over time started to interpret that law that was supposed to be so groundbreaking really narrowly as to who could qualify as having a disability to get access to the protections under that law. So I think when you're thinking about legislation, you have to realize that you're going to have to potentially revisit that legislation over time and build the consensus necessary to do so. So the American with Disabilities Act was amended to try to broaden back up that definition to what I would say, you know, the congressional record said was the original intent of more of the original intent of the law. So I think when you're thinking about those kind of legislative reforms, you have to realize they will have to be revisited over time, and there could be intersections with other forms and parts of the government that would make the law become something that it wasn't intended to be.
Absolutely. Also, I wonder if when you mentioned that Title IX of the convention talks about accessibility, yes, go ahead, Val.
No, I was just thinking, because you mentioned the protection and advocacy organization.
Yes.
And how crucial it's been over the last several decades. But there's a group in New Zealand that's been developing some guidelines on how to create a truly self-directed system of services. And one of the things they mention is compliance. I mean, it's one thing to assert these aspirations that are in the CRPD and the ADA, but unless you've got a compliance entity on the ground that holds providers and others' feet to the fire, it really just stays an aspiration.
Absolutely, absolutely. And this is part of the premise of the protection and advocacy systems. Yes, yes, definitely an asset. Go ahead.
I want the laws to play fair so things and people with their dream jobs wouldn't be so hard and difficult to earn it.
Absolutely. Yes, your voice matters.
Well, when it comes to bills like ADA, affirmative action is one thing that should definitely be emphasized more. Emphasize more employment, health disparities. Like, you know, one thing, you know, one area where we haven't seen, you know, as much progress as we'd like is the area of employment when we look at 30 plus years of ADA. And even right now with a workforce shortage, you know, you're still seeing employment challenges among the disability community. And right now, you know, if Congress, you know, would help, you know, get rid of all benefit cliffs and all that, you know, that could definitely help in, you know, solving the current workforce crisis, you know. And let's have affirmative action. Let's put requirements. All disability provider agencies and all nonprofits should be required to hire people with disabilities. You know, it's nice that we're doing racial equity and all that, but we need to bring the disability lens to it. We need to start talking about ableism. This pandemic has revealed how much ableism we have, and look at all these long haulers. You know, look how many people this pandemic is disabling. And, you know, you see health disparities, you know, doctors, you know, saying, oh, everything's normal, yet you don't feel it normal. You hear stories of people, you know, struggling to deal with the disability benefit system who now have long COVID. It's time to wake up. It's time for a reckoning. Disability is not left, right, center.
Thank you. Is that Nicole?
I think Kathy and then Topper.
Is that Nicole? Oh, hi, Nicole. Nicole was in the video as well, a great voice. Thank you, Nicole, for that. And that brings home even terminology, because you were talking about ableism, for instance, and those things are important. But again, when people with disabilities are brought to the table, a lot of those things surface in policy development. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, hi. I'm Karen Topper. I'm from Vermont. And I want to comment on the including people with disabilities in policymaking. Something Hassan, he's not here right now, but something he said to me very recently was that, you know, it's not just about, or he suggested, not just about people with disabilities going to the policymaking tables. That's really important. But Hassan said, why don't they come to us? Like, why don't they spend as much time in our local self-advocacy groups? And I would just like to add, you know, the beauty of that in some way is that no matter what we do and we say that we're going to make those policy tables accessible, they usually aren't, you know, without a whole lot of work ahead of time or afterwards to process the information. So the beauty of Hassan's suggestions of making sure they spend just as much time coming to us is that those settings are already accessible because they're run by people with intellectual disabilities, and so it's going to be an easier place for people to feel comfortable in commenting and understanding.
Great points. One more person, and then we'll move to the next question.
The other point I think I would make is that whatever the systems that are being contemplated or the legislation that's being contemplated, we need to build in safeguards to those that and redundancies. And so the protection and advocacy system in the United States is a very good example, so that to the extent that things go off kilter, and they do, and unfortunately with a fair degree of regularity, that there are systems in place to challenge that and to take up those issues as they happen, and to challenge states that are not complying or systems that are not complying and that are, you know, letting people with disabilities down and letting down the intent of the law. So as somebody who spends a lot of time running around doing that, I think, you know, there's no shortage of work to be done. And we were talking with people in New Zealand about just the importance of the protection, independent advocacy system that's there for people with disabilities, not providers, not the government, you know, but really right there with fidelity to the people.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you. Did you want to say something to you? You are the special guest, so you might as well.
Well, I just think that more people with disabilities are, again, emphasizing on those important committees that are about our lives. We should be included at the very beginning, not the afterthought, not the in-between, not the check mark on your to-do list, but at the very beginning, ask our opinions at the very beginning, build those relationships ahead of time, and then ask us if we want to be a part of that. We have lives too, and we can't be doing everything for you all the time either. So, but giving us the information in a way that's accessible, that we understand it, how is this going to help me in my life to make it better? How is it going to help my friends to make their lives better? Simple language like that on the things that you tell us, because sometimes people don't understand 50% of the blah, 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 the nation wants you to go, blah, blah, blah. And by the time that happens, you've lost half the people because they're not understanding all that information like that, but making it accessible in a way that people can understand it. And then they're going to be willing to be a part of it and to help you make a difference, because we can say some things that are to Congress people or to other people that you as a professional might not be able to say. But we can get that point across for you and for us in a different way that's going to make a difference.
Absolutely. Thank you, Tia, for having the last word. So question number two. And, of course, keep your ears peeled because you all will be contributing too. How do we ensure that we are better able to support people with disabilities when they are at the age of retirement? And I wanted to bring forth that ACL, the Administration for Community Living, we exist because anyone, regardless of age or disability, should be able to participate fully in their community and be able to make choices, you know, have choices and make decisions or be in control of those decisions. So we exist because of that. So we think of people in terms of the lifespan. So you have a disability, but you know, there is from infant and through your life, that includes the retirement age. So one of the things that we can do, certainly enact certain policies. Another has to do with some of the programs that we have created, even under the Projects of National Significance and within AOA as well. There was funding most recently. I think the announcement came out, was it Friday? For the direct care workforce, a capacity building center. And because we know in the United States we have such a caregiver crisis, and so this is our way of assisting, supporting both older adults, and the AOA notes that older adults are those that are 60 and above, and people with disabilities, of course, within having a lifespan issue, having the lifespan piece of it. So those are the things at the top of my head that I think of in terms of, let me see, you see, at the age of retirement. I'm also thinking of ACL, AOA, and AOD, meaning the Administration on Aging and the Administration on Disabilities, coordinating, intersecting different programs, policies, and the way in which we interact with each other. So I'm going to pause here and see whom else has. Go ahead, Ruby.
Yeah, I just, we've got a bunch of employment experts in the room, so I'm just going to say this since it's ending. But
yes.
I mean, I think when we ask the question about retirement, the first thing that pops to mind for me is retiring from what? And so I think we have to do a better job of making sure that people get the supports and opportunities and have the expectations of having a fabulous long career, great wages, benefits, opportunities for advancement, so that when the, you know, whatever age that is, because there's a bunch of people at my table that have passed those ages and we're still happily,
oh, that's why you were laughing. Okay.
But I do want to say that we have to do better on the career support front so that retirement is actually a meaningful term as opposed to just having more of nothing terribly interesting.
That's a perspective. Yes, yes. Anyone else?
How we can really help people when it comes to retirement is, while they're in the job, I think they should have people, boss or whatever that thing is mean to you, is have sit down with your boss and you know, say, what are you looking to retire with? Like, what is your plan looks like? So having those conversations and really starting those conversations with the people that you're working with or working for, so everyone in that team can be on the same page and also, you know, talking to them instead of at them, because those can be very two different ways to talk to people. But yeah.
No, this is wonderful, because communication is a lost art. And at the base of anything, we are supposed to be able to communicate our needs. Go ahead, Nicole.
One thing is, like, you know, like, let's remove, you know, allow people to keep, you know, buying into Medicaid, just like, you know, we have Medicaid buy-in for people with disabilities. Allow them to keep buying in even once they hit that, beyond that 64 age limit. In addition, you know, we see struggling to get ABLE accounts, people to open them. You know, ABLE accounts can be used as a retirement vehicle. Employers can contribute to them. You know, for instance, I have, you know, HSRI contribute to my ABLE account. So ABLE accounts are, you know, something that can be used. It can be used both as a short-term, long-term, you know. And then, of course, you know, and the beauty of an ABLE account is, you know, you don't need to worry about anything if, you know, anything happens, whereas with a 401k or what have you. And plus, you know, like in my state, our ABLE program, there's no Medicaid payback. We get a $2,500 tax deduction as an individual and $5,000 for a couple, which is good to know for anybody who donates to people's ABLE accounts in the same state.
I'm Anna. I'm from the Massachusetts Developmental Disabilities Council. So hi, everyone. And I just, it's not exactly about retirement, but I couldn't resist responding to something that Ruby said, because it ties into the caregiver crisis, which is, you know, I talk with lots of other developmental disability councils. There's also one in every state, also funded by ACL. And everyone is grappling with the caregiver crisis in all different ways. And we are not talking about employment enough. Like, guess what? People don't need to go to a day hab if they're employed, you know, and it's this opportunity to change the conversation. Thank you, I agree with myself. It's this opportunity to change the conversation and really reprioritize, and I think it's this once in a generation opportunity with the negative that has come from the pandemic. So I'm excited to see where it goes, and I hope that people really embrace this concept more and start just truly living employment first rather than just saying employment first.
Oh, I just want to say that, my name is Katina Atmore, and I work at the Georgia Advocacy Office. And, you know, I think a lot about the work that I do around citizen advocacy, which comes from the community side of things. And we like to say that we encourage people to do typical things in typical ways. And so sometimes what I'm thinking, like when we're thinking about the retirement, I don't understand why we can't think about that in a typical way. Like, how do we think about retirement for ourselves, right? And I actually brought two people together in a relationship. One is an accountant. Her thing is to save money. So she became an advocate for a woman whose family was taking her check, and she saved over $8,000. And she's just like, I've got to figure out how to spend this money so she doesn't lose it. And it's so sad. We were just like, well, why couldn't she just save it? So now we're having a conversation about putting it in an ABLE account so that she doesn't lose it. But, you know, it's just common sense stuff that I really want us to kind of wrap our arms around for people.
So to summarize what all of us were saying for question number two, we mentioned communication, we mentioned knowledge, empowerment, and even tailoring to the person. And at the heart of all of that, it goes to listening, being able to listen to what is needed. Go ahead, Tia, you'll have the last word. So we have to go to the...
I think we should concentrate more on careers than just jobs. Because when people with disabilities, when you're thinking of someone having a career, you think of the different mindset than to someone just having a job. Because you're thinking more of, when you're talking about career, you're thinking about more advanced in their life, further down the future too, besides just that job right then. you're thinking about employment with benefits and retirement and sick leave and paid holidays, those opportunities that you're thinking of. And one of the things that I want to think to talk about ACL did was we did a youth employment grant, and we talked about employment and grant and self-advocacy and, you know, and jobs and careers and stuff. So my dream is to put together an app around careers and helping people with disability look at careers and use it through an app, and it celebrates each step that they finish through looking at how you talk about careers and wanting to do their careers. And you can build an avatar to help you go through that chart of those things. And you can use it on your, hopefully on your iPad and your computer, so you could take that with you. And at the end, it would take all your information that you put in there and store it so that when you go and show somebody, they can maybe help you advance on the things that you're working on to get a career. So that's what I'm working on, is making it accessible for people with disabilities to use it and not just sit on the shelf and have to wait for their support person to help them use it, but it to be accessible and to have them be able to take it with them and show their neighbor or their friends or their family or other relatives, this is my career that I'm interested in. What can you do to help me and make that a possibility so more people have jobs and a career in their life?
Absolutely. And we would expect nothing less from you, Tia. So thank you for that. And, you know, a shout out to Endeem relating to that as well, that the goal really is that we don't focus on jobs, but rather careers, because we know that it gets us to being independent and, you know, participating in our communities. So, yes. Okay, a little time left, but hopefully I can get some feedback on this one. Question three says, given the erosion of the home and community-based system settings rule and the legal vulnerability of early and periodic screening, diagnostic, and treatment, and OMSTED, what policy tools do we have to support this level of growth in the next 30 years? So this is a little outside of me, because part of this has to do with Medicaid, we don't necessarily administer Medicaid at ACL, but we do know that Medicaid, CMS, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, they are the ones that arrange for screening. There are reportings that have to be done on the performance of those, as well as anyone who is under the age of 21. You know, the EPSDT services are available for them as well. But anyone else, since this is outside of my little circle, anyone else would like to provide any feedback relating to this piece? Val?
Yeah, at HSRI, I believe with money from ACL, we have been working with a variety of national advocates who in turn have networks of stakeholders in states. So one way of making sure that states, again, feet to the fire, is by really intentionally organizing a whole raft of stakeholders, helping them understand at the state and local level what the stakes really are here, and giving them the information and support they need. And that's at least the intention of our work with these national advocacy organizations. And I think we're beginning to see a little movement, but this is going to take everybody in organizations around the country being aware of when stakeholder input is supposed to take place, understanding what the issues are in that state, and showing up.
Yes, yeah, so that brings up the point. Thank you, Val. I would. This brings up the point of collaboration. And, you know, even when we started sort of the discussion, and we needed everyone to be the right people to be at the table and be at the table early. So even as it relates to HCBS, the HCBS settings rule, we need everyone to be able to be at the table at the right time, getting everything done. Because what ends up happening, if the right people are not at the table early, we end up backtracking. And we already, because we are talking about people's lives here. So it negatively impacts whatever it is that we are doing or even trying to do at this point. So yes, we totally agree, even at ACL, with collaboration. And this is why we are encouraging collaboration at every level to get us to the point that we need to get us to the goal that we want to reach in all of this. Anyone else before we pause from here? Okay.
So my name is Dana Lloyd. I work at the Georgia Advocacy Office. That was my question. And maybe a clarifier would be, there was movement, right, towards changing our civil rights law to include people with disabilities. And there seems to be a slow erosion in the other direction now. And so given that slow erosion, whether it's in the law via the ADA and the integration mandate, whether it's in our CMS policies, how do we hold ground? And like I'm kind of personally upset by the erosion of the settings rule, right? Because that seemed like a step forward. So how do we hold ground in our current political climate and move policy forward to continue this rate of growth we've had in the last 30 years? That didn't fit in the text box, but that's the question.
We are supposed to speak out because the laws I enacted, we try to support those laws in different ways. And depending on who has the voice, things get paused or things even get eroded. So we need your voice. And that is really what we need at every level, your voice. And so even if it feels like you are saying the same thing over and over again, this is what gets us change. This is what gets us change. Your voice, along with the voice of other people who are as passionate as you are, as really, I could tell you were passionate. You are really upset about it. Get other people who are like you and be able to get things. And, oh, I thought somebody else was talking. I'm sorry. And that is where it begins. Because one person can get powerful, you get other people together, and it multiplies even over. That is how laws are passed. That is how movement happens. So I would say just continue on the path that you are. At the federal level, we certainly are trying. We certainly are trying. Yes. So it appears that this wonderful time that we were having has come to an end. If there are other questions that you all put in, we will try to go ahead and answer them on some level, even if it means through the app or so, we'll try to get them answered. I don't know if Kathy is in here, that if anything else comes up, we'll be able to share with the organizers so that you all will have the answers that you need. But I thank you so much for your participation, your attention, and just for being here and speaking with one voice. So thank you.